But you can see that in this method, we are computing a little bit more than what we are computing in the first order Euler method. So, it is always a balance between how much you want to compute and how much accuracy you would like. Okay. In fact, you can now design methods which have even higher order accuracy. So, you can design third order methods, fourth order methods and so on. And let me show you some examples. So, we can have a class of methods called the Runge-Kutta methods. Which are higher order accurate. So, let me give you an example. So, I will give you an example of a fourth order accurate method. Okay, just to give you a flavor. So, we are going to argue the following. We will say let x n plus 1 be given as x n plus h. And then I am going to use an intermediate variable k 1 that this is simply h times the slope times and the slope is evaluated at this initial point x n y n. So, that I am going to call k 1 and then I am going to use k 2 another variable which is h times f of x n plus half and y n plus half k 1. I hope you are able to see what we are doing. So, you can notice k 1 is actually simply if you notice from here, we said y star n plus 1 was y n plus this term. So, you can see h times f n is the increment to y n that we have computed. Okay? So, just like h is the increment to x, you can think of k as an increment to y. Okay? So, we first estimate the increment and then we again estimate another increment based on the slope which is halfway through, all right. And then we can do k 3 which is h times f of x n plus half h and this time we use the value half k 2. So, we are using a more modified value of y to calculate the slope and we also use k 4 which is h times f x n plus half h and this time we are going to use y n plus half of k 3. And now, my formula that I want to use is y n plus 1 is y n plus 1/6 of my k 1 plus twice k 2 plus twice k 3 plus k 4. Okay. So, this method is you can show, but I am not going to show here that this will be a fourth order accurate method. Okay, why is that? If you look at the first order Euler method, we were computing the slope only at the initial point. Then we went to the second order method and we modified our way of computing the slope and we said, well, it should be based on the initial point and then the second point. Where actually we want to evaluate y. And now we are doing it at more intermediate points. Okay? And that is why this method has a higher order accuracy. And I can keep on modifying this to get more accuracy, but at the expense of doing more calculations. Okay? So, now you have a choice as you can see. Even for solving this simple ordinary differential equation, you could say, hey, I just want to take a smaller h and be done with it. So I'll go ahead with the first order Euler method, okay, and I keep reducing my step size, and that way I would get smaller error as that step size reduces. The other strategy is that no, I don't want to reduce my step size, h remains the same, okay, but I am going to now go to higher order, okay, and therefore I will reduce the error. If you remember, the error in the first order Euler method was some coefficient times h, and the error here would be some coefficient times h to the fourth. Okay, so this is going to be hopefully a smaller error than you would incur in the first order method, but of course the coefficients in the two methods are different. Okay. Okay, there are other methods that we can use. So far we have used only one step at a time, which is n and n plus 1. So we knew the value at n, this is known and this is unknown. I could design methods where I can come up with the multi-step methods. So in the multi-step methods, I could actually have still n plus 1 as my unknown, but I could say, well, my knowns are, I will use the value at n, perhaps at n minus 1, perhaps at n minus 2, and so on. So I will use several values at earlier steps to estimate the answer at n plus 1. And it turns out this can also give us some interesting results. All right, so let me describe to you a multi-step method. And I'll just show you one example, which is the Adams-Bashford method. Just as an illustration, the idea is that we are going to use values of y at the preceding steps also, not just simply at yn. So the challenge is to estimate y n plus 1, and we already have done methods which use simply y n. So the differential equation is the following. We have y prime of x as simply f of x y. And of course, the initial value is that y at x 0 is y 0. So I can simply integrate this. So if I integrate this from xn to xn plus 1, then I get y prime x dx. This is xn to xn plus 1 f x of y dx. And this, of course, we know this value is simply y n plus 1 minus y at n. This, of course, I have written y at x n plus 1, and this one is y at xn. So it's just a notation. Okay, the xn plus 1, please recall this is given as x 0 plus n h. Sorry, this is xn, and xn plus 1 is x 0 plus n plus 1 h. So to get y n plus 1, we have so far used the fact that the slope depends on the value that xn and xn plus 1. But I could introduce a multi-step method where f is actually an interpolation and it depends on the earlier values of the slope. So let me give you one example. So we are going to replace f of xy with a polynomial of degree 3 that satisfies the following four conditions. So I am going to pass a cubic polynomial by using these following four conditions. So remember, we had these different points, okay, which we have discretized. So the first condition that I use is that f n is simply f of x n y n. The second one is that f n minus 1 is going to be given as f of x n minus 1 and y n minus 1. And the third condition is that f of n minus 2 is x n minus 2 y n minus 2. And the final one is on f n minus 3, which is essentially f of x n minus 3 y n minus. So I will use the polynomial in this interval x n to x n plus 1, but the one which is based on this interpolation. Okay. And if I do that, so I will fit this polynomial so through four points. And plug it in the integral. And then I can show that my y star n plus 1 from this formula would actually be given as yn plus h by 24. And the values would be 55 fn minus 59 fn minus 1 plus 35 fn minus 2 minus 9 fn minus 3. And you can see that y star n plus 1 actually now depends on slope at n and three earlier values of earlier grid points, which are essentially n minus 1, n minus 2 and n minus 3. Okay. Now this method looks very attractive, but it has a problem. Okay. So the method has a problem in starting. Imagine I want to compute for the first time, okay, the first step. So I know the solution at x0, and now I want to estimate the solution at the first point y1, and now it requires these values which actually don't exist. Okay, so I have several options. One is I estimate these values, but probably an easier option is that for the first few time steps I use the first order Euler method, then the second order Euler method, then so on. Okay, so to overcome this problem is that the first few values can be computed from lower order methods. So I gave you this example to kind of keep in mind that whenever you design a higher order method which uses several grid points, okay, you are always going to be stuck with this problem, that on the face of it, it looks like it is very attractive, but then you will realize that close to the boundaries or close to the initial value, you possibly are back to a lower order method, okay, and then that error will also propagate. Okay, so on the face of it, you are higher order in the middle of the domain or at later times, but you have incurred some error at initial time, and one should be wary of that. In that sense, there is a distinction between the two methods. So the first order method that we did is self-starting. Okay, so it doesn't need any extra value to start. Okay, but then you look at these multi-step methods, they are not self-starting. They have to be given a push to get some initial solutions. All right, so I think I have given you some exposure on how to look at ordinary differential equations. What about partial differential equations? Now, as you are aware, you are going to have partial derivatives when you talk about partial differential equations. So, just let us take an example in two dimensions. Let us say this is x, this is y. And now I am interested in a certain point x and y. So if phi is a quantity that depends on xy, then I can talk about these derivatives, for example del phi by del x, where y is to be held constant, versus del phi by del y, where x has to be held constant. So the interpretation of these derivatives is extremely important for numerical methods. Okay. So the straightforward interpretation is that if I am looking at, let us say, del phi by del x at this point, then I should be looking at some variations where y is constant. So I should draw y equal to constant line. And likewise, when I look at del phi by del y, I should be looking at a line along which x is constant. So how do you design numerical methods for these schemes? One thing we should keep in mind is that we must respect the physics. So whatever numerical method you use, it should keep in mind the physics that the differential equation is trying to model. So it is useful to look at the classification of various methods. So let me give you a second order partial differential equation, and then we will look at its classifications. You have probably seen this, but I will just review this. So a PDE is quasi-linear if it is linear in the highest derivative. All right. So we look at a second order quasi-linear equation in two independent variables. So this equation I am going to write as A del square u by del x square plus twice B del square u by del x del y plus C times del square u by del y square, and this is equal to f, which is a function of x, y, u by del x and del u by del y. And then of course it will have some boundary conditions. We will talk about boundary conditions in a few minutes. A, B and C are functions of x and y. Okay? So I can classify this equation in one of the three types by looking at this quantity b square minus ac. So if I look at b square minus ac, this quantity could be either equal to 0 or less than 0 or greater than 0. If the quantity is less than 0, then I am going to say that my equations are elliptic. So you are familiar with elliptic equations. For example, the Laplace equation is an elliptic equation. Example, the Laplace equation, which all of us are familiar with, del square u is, let's say, equal to f. Well, in the Laplace equation, the right-hand side is homogeneous, so I'm going to put a 0 there. All right, so that's an elliptic equation. What happens if my b square minus ac is 0? Then I am going to be talking about a parabolic equation. Okay? And an example of a parabolic equation is the heat equation. And if I have greater than 0, then I am talking about a hyperbolic equation. And there are several examples of hyperbolic equations, but one very well known example is the wave equation. Now the idea is that any numerical method that you would devise to solve this partial differential equation, it must respect the physics. So if I choose a method to solve, let's say, the Laplace equation, which is an elliptic equation, and I try to use the same method to solve my heat equation, which is a parabolic equation, in principle things could go wrong. Okay? So it is always a good idea to identify what is the physics of the problem in terms of one of these three classifications, and then use an appropriate method. In fact, the boundary conditions would also have to be specified depending on what kind of a transport that you have, or what is the kind of differential equation you have. So, as far as this course is concerned, we are going to be talking about two kinds of boundary conditions. A boundary where my u is specified. Okay. So, suppose I am talking about a heat equation, then u could be some kind of a temperature. So, I could have a part of the boundary where temperature is specified. So, that is a Dirichlet boundary. I could have another part of the boundary where the condition is not on the temperature, but the derivative of temperature, something like the heat flux. So, that kind of a boundary we would denote as a Neumann boundary. So, essentially two boundary conditions, a Dirichlet condition and a Neumann condition. So, let me just summarize that for you very briefly. So, the boundary conditions. So, let us say this is my domain on which I am solving this equation, and this is my boundary which I denote by gamma. So, omega is the domain, a two-dimensional domain, and gamma is my boundary. I could have a Dirichlet boundary where u is specified. Okay, the boundary condition is on u. Or I could have something called a Neumann boundary wherein the condition is, let us say, on un, which is actually the gradient of u dotted with n, where n could be the unit normal vector. So, this n is the unit normal. So, this is like the heat flux, okay, the normal component of the heat flux. So, I could specify, for example, that I have an adiabatic condition, that means there is no heat flux, or I could specify how much is the heat flux. In some cases, I could also have a mixed boundary wherein u and un, their linear combination is prescribed. So, I could have a situation where a temperature times a condition on heat flux. So, temperature plus a condition on heat flux is specified rather than these two independently. Okay. But we are not going to deal with the mixed boundary conditions in this course. We will only deal with Dirichlet and Neumann. Okay, we will stop here, and in the next class we are going to look at some very simple methods on how to solve some of these differential equations in two dimensions. Thank you.